Good afternoon, one and all, to our weekly Dot Talks webinar series. This is Dr. Aniruddha Babar, your host. Today we have a special guest who will be speaking on religion, politics, and terrorism, a critical analysis of narratives of Islamic terrorism. He is Mr. Muhammad Baharul Islam, Assistant Professor, Iqfa Law School, the Iqfa University in Tripura. I, on behalf of Texo College, sir, I welcome you. Please take your time.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, may I start, sir?
Sure, sir. Please go ahead.
Before starting my presentation, so I would like to thank Texo College and the organizer for giving me this wonderful opportunity to discuss such a wonderful topic. Every day we came across this topic and we are familiar with this topic, but only few people would like to talk about this topic. So in this occasion, I would like to give my special thanks to Aniruddha sir, who has constantly supported me from the very beginning. Thank you so much, sir. And another special person who has nominated me for and encouraged me for discussing and placing my view on this topic. This is none other than our Dr. Krishnamani sir. So thank you all. So first of all, I'd like to say that I am not an expert of this topic, but I am a researcher on this topic, and I'll share my research findings among all the participants. So after my presentation, if anyone is having any doubt, I'll be open for the discussion. So sir, I would like to share my screen. I think someone else has already shared the screen. Okay. So, sir, is it visible? Another sir, my screen is visible. Hello? Thank you. Terrorism, the word terrorism in the 21st century, everybody is familiar with this, the concept of the terrorism. So I'll start with an introduction about my topic. See, terrorism is an ancient phenomenon as it comes from the classical antiquity. However, it is a global version, only started in the last decades of 19th century, after the fall of Paris Commune and the murder of the Russian Tsar Alexander the Second. Yes, sir.
Sir.
Is there any issue, sir? Hello. Sir, may I continue? So global terrorism is a phenomenon in which, according to Rapoport, the renowned jurist, so his opinion, we can consider the four webs with religious one as its present face and ubiquitous features of the contemporary terrorism discourse, observable in a great many political, academics, and popular texts. It's a deeply problematic notion of Islamic terrorism, a term which comes laden with its own sets of unacknowledged assumptions and embedded cultural narratives. The political significance of this particular discursive formation can be observed in the way in which policy officials frequently define the primary terrorism challenges as one of the responding to Islamic extremism and terrorism. While problematic is still shadowing the intentionally accepted definition, the word terrorism becomes trending topics in global politics and academic discourse. In the first decades of millennium, a war on terrorism is not likely to end. Now, what is the social psychology of the terrorism? We need to understand that why people are involving into the terrorism. So, psychological profiles of the terrorists have revealed that in general, they are fairly typical of the groups from which they came. And these groups are especially prone sensitive to the consequences of the domination. Indeed, terrorist organizations do not want unstable, psychotic individuals who may be unpredictable. Terrorists may be more assertive and outgoing, but there is little evidence of striking psychopathology or irrational hatreds. What is being suggested is that terrorists are people who desire what most people want, but the conditions in which terrorists live foster limited options. Their social ties, no longer community attitude, self-realization and fulfillment, become blocked by the structural conditions and the emotion this condition generates. Between the humiliations of deintegration, powerlessness in face of domination, and hopelessness for the expected future, terrorism becomes a means to a goal that ameliorates earlier nations. The first desire of the, or the first psychological aspect of the terrorist is that they demand identity and they would like to fulfill their desire. Identity as a conscious scripts and narratives of the statehoods, self-identity for Gibson, it is a meditating linkage between the individual, dynamically understood, and the larger society. One's identity is not simply a set of identifications, but is a reflective, conscious locus of subjectivity. As it moves through the flow of the social times and space seeking affective gratifications. In the enactment of the routines of everyday life, but this is also the site where the frustration, humiliation, or insults are experienced. Otherwise, say people seek emotional gratifications or the avoidance of the frustration. This is not a simple hedonism in that people will suffer great deprivation or sustain their identities. They may even give their lives people a seek membership and attachments in identity, granting communities of meaning that provide social bonds and attachments, strives for recognition and dignity, granting statutes, exercise agency, striving to overcome powerlessness, and given universal fear of death, seek a value system that provides explanation for pain, suffering and injustice, remedies and a promise of amelioration, even if in the next life. The second sociological or psychological aspect is character and the reaction to domination. Every political groups or the members would like to dominate the world. When domination is imposed from without and internalized at the level of the character, when recognition, dignity and agency are frustrated or denied, when selfhood is humiliated and enthralled, the person both reproduces the structure condition of subtlety, the third resistance at the price of the person's actualization and fulfillment. The rise of the Christian hegemon and finally colonialization foster resentment and the desire for average, but that revenge would consume and destroy the self. Moving from Nazis to the fruit, resentment based on domination, deintegration, shame and humiliation of being inferior to a powerful other can be interpreted in terms of insult or character and dignity and frustration, denial of desires for community, agency, recognitions and meaning. The terrorism and the identity. Every terrorist group or every terrorist organization is always looking for the identity. They would like to establish their identity. This is another psychological aspect of the terrorist groups. Young man in particular, social, cultural, allocation are especially prone to certain social and political stress and influences that foster their identities. The lower middle class of Islam tends to religiously observant, fearful of modernity and resentful of their condition. The range of unemployment, subjugated and humiliated is much the same whether the patriots of America, the marginalized lower middle classes of rural America or the soul of the Middle East. Young man without alternative source of agency and respect turn to compensatory identities of hate and violence, priest in cult of death. For young man without work and socialized into traditional Islam, resentment is not only a hateful envy in response to political economic domination, but is also directed to racial, cultural subjugation and humiliation, this emasculation, dispose, hate and violence. Now I'd like to discuss the reason fall of the Islams. I have divided this into three categories: the rise of Islam and the Islam trumps and the fall of Islams. The rise of Islams, I'll give a brief idea about the rise of Islams. In the 7th century, the conflict between the Persia and the Byzantium forced us a southerly movement of the trade route through the desert of Arabia that were largely populated by warrants of nomadic tribes, ever involved in Vedanta and counter-Vedanta. Particular strict tribal religious roots as barrier to the expansion of the urban merchant class and threatened the security of the caravans. This condition was disposed the emergence of the unifying religion that would extend across many lands, uniting the populations and securing general conditions for aggressive commerce and trade. Muhammad and illiterate merchants, I am using the term illiterate because Muhammad has never visited any school or went to any school. Illiterate merchants articulated a divine message attributed to Archangel Jibril. Jibril is an angel. As an emissary of Allah, he would become a charismatic prophet.
Allow me to interrupt for a while. Mr. Roman Islam, you are sharing your screen. Can you please switch it off? Mr. Roman Islam, you are sharing your screen. Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Please. Thank you, sir. So, Muhammad, an illiterate merchant, articulated a divine message attributed to the Archangel Jibril. Jibril was an angel. As an emissary of the Allah, he would become a charismatic prophet. The Quran, the word of the Allah God, become the foundation of a new faith that provides a monotheistic salvation religion rooted in both Jewish and the Christian traditions of the prophecy, incorporating their ethics and many of their customs. Muhammad, as a prophet and a skilled arbitrator, found a ready audience among the growing class of merchants whose status disposed an elective affinity for a salvation religion that would establish an emergent community of people united by faith that provide members with valorized secularized identities and the God and a God oriented ethical regulation of everyday conduct conducive to commerce. So now the Islam trumpet, this is the highlight of the Islamic period, or the biggest achievement of the Islamic period. Within 500 years, Islam has spread across vast tracts of the North America, the Middle East, the Caucasus, India, and the part of Asia from China to what is now Indonesia and Malaysia. As Islam initially spread institutionalizing faith and laws, it established the condition in which a new kind of society of merchants emerged. Economic trade was sponsored by the religion in a number of ways, supported by the flows of large population, making the Hajj and extensive trade networks help sustain an Islamic world across many cultural boundaries. Arabic became the lingua franca for the realm. A banking network eventually formed. Islam was spread outside the Arab world by trade, by merchant, not by war or the conquest. The fairly universal Islamic law, Sharia, also enabled the expansion of the trade throughout the region. Now, the decline of the Islam. I have find out few points, and I think these are the reason which is behind the fall or decline of the Islam. There are a number of reasons why Christendom suppressed Islam, given the nature of sultanism and dynastic rule, patrimonial organization, or religious orientation rooted in a warrior ethics, and other factors outlined below. Islam presented formidable barriers to the economic modernization, for the diffusion of the instrumental rationality, individualism, the embrace of democratic institution and rational metrocratic bureaucratic administration. There are 7 factors limited the impact of foreign ideas and or created indigenous barriers to the emergence of economic, political and cultural rationality that embedded Christendom and in turn capitalist modernity, quasi-secular national administrative rationality and a culture of the critique and equality. Here are these 7 reasons behind the fall of the Islams. economic barrier and the law. For Weber, the great jurist establishing the legal tradition of the Islams were more legal prophets establishing substantive theological stereotype juristic law that opposes secularization, the formal juridical legal codes. Sacred law eliminates the space for the predictable legal procedures. The economic practice directed by Quranic law, Qazi justice and Hanafi code thus precluded large-scale economic enterprise and capital accumulations. Second, Islam as a decentralized religion. Another reason is that Islam's while a world religion, unlike Roman Christianity, was decentralized without a singular supreme authority or centralized hierarchy. This enabled a number of competing learning centers and variations in local practice and precluded reformations as a form of resistance to church control, as Islam remained compatible with both its merchant and warrior traditions. There did not emerge an oppositional class that would foster a public sphere, embrace a separation of church and state, and foster a systematic critique of the religious dogma. In this reason, many most Islamic states openly embrace Sharia law, while theological districts are often met with fatwas, religious legal decree to maintain orthodoxy and ensure adherence to Islamic society. Without reformation, in spite of the advanced development of science, philosophy, technology, and ethical legal thoughts, and eliminated enlightenment based embrace of modernity and its secular institution and politics was not forthcoming. The third point is that a theology of the determinations. It is important here to note that the difference between the theology of predestination and the Protestantism and the predetermination in Islam. The former is based on problematic salvation in the next world, and the latter on guarantee of Allah's will in this. Thus, the power of Allah to impact this world disposes a fatalism that would stifle the attempt to control or the dominate nature and other people inherent to capitalism, in which salvation, anxiety provided, and inner determination that impel economic action toward this orderly esotericism and methodological orientation to everyday life, in which each moment was part of a career. Thus, guilt and turning inwards were essential moment of Protestantism. Otherwise said, Islam did not guarantee that intense salvation anxiety that becomes a compulsive orientation to work seen as a morality based on vocational and sacrificed career. The fourth one is political centralization. It is also necessary to note that whereas ascetic Protestantism was a rational bourgeois religion from the start, Islam began as a religion of a ruling stratum, harem religion, and to a large extent, despite its formal egalitarianism, it disposed the acceptance of the caliphism, sultanism, and or other forms of dynastic rules, and more often than not, legitimate suppression of democratization and pluralism. In this way, there is a little difference between God-oriented kings, presidents for life, and one-party states. Both internal and external political forces exhibit these trends. The fifth one is the close relation of church, dynasties, and the commerce. There was a seamless relation between the mosque, political dynasty, and the merchant class. Indeed, many mullahs and the imams either came from the merchant class, were themselves still actively engaged in commerce and the trade. The merchant class could not find themselves in conflicts with the existing political arrangements in Islamic society, partly due to the close regulation, sponsorship, and housing of market by political and religious authorities. As merchant class, that would not become a powerful autonomous class, and did as did the Europeans, nor would they stand in opposition of the ruling class. That Islamic societies did not have social condition disposing an ideological critique of dynastic rule of religion. The sixth point is conservatism and the limit to diffusions. In this maturity, in fact, of challenge and weakened by internal strife, Islamic society turned to orthodoxy and resistance to change. Indeed, in sharp contrast to early Islamic society, later societies actively maintained various barriers to external cultural influence. While this reproduced Islamic culture and preserved social arrangement, it created the condition that resists the incorporation of Western innovation and factories of nationalism, etc. this highly advanced Islamic pursuit of science and philosophy ceased to develop. The last one is individualism and pluralism. Perhaps one of the most important moments of modernity was the rise of the autonomous, self-interested individual with the capacities to adapt the new situations. The importance of individuals in the West can clearly be seen in contrast to the value of the community, Ummah, in Islam. One of the central factors that hindered the spread of modernity in Islam has been the intolerance of individualism, the absence of commitment to individual rights and personal freedom, which serves to limit change and the innovation. The nature of Islamic theology, ethics, culture, and law limit the impact of foreign ideas and or the emergence of the economic, political, and cultural rationality. Now, the fourth point is the narrative of the characteristics of Islamic terrorism. So the widely held discussion on the terrorism in the wake of the September 11, 2001, the attack of the World Trade Center, even the United States have almost certainly touched the debate on Islam and on at least the Muslims. This is highly ironic. Terrorism, which means violent act with a political goal carried out by creating a terrifying situation, is labeled on Islam, a religion which literally means greatness, submission, and leading to the purpose of the peace of the world and life afterwards. This irony also continues as the word Islamic terrorism is repeatedly mentioned by merely refers to a common sense where there is no definite definition that describes its specification. Assumptions that arise and become a description when the term Islamic terrorism is used generally to refer a concept as defined as follows: a form of religious terrorism committed by extremists of Islam, mostly for the religious belief, and sometimes to achieving varying political ends against the name of the religion. So violence with religion, religious motifs are in fact not sometimes new and certainly not exclusively practiced by adherents of a particular religion. History has recorded a long documentation of violence against other groups on the basis of the conviction. However, which actions are regarded as terrorism and which are not is a big problem because they have political consequence and have implication for moral thoughtics. Major mainstream influence powers in the world and the policy directions of the intense media campaign in the publicity have a dominant role in determining to which group label of the terrorism is pinned. The geopolitical discourse situation and international policy also have the same contribution involved. Now, there are a few reasons, there are a few categories through which we can we would like to discuss the narrative characteristics of the Islamic terrorism. The genealogy of discourse of the Islamic terrorism. The genealogical discourse approach is based on the fact that a text always refers to other texts that also rely on texts that have been there before. However, there are at least three common explanations that could describe how the concept of Islamic terrorism that is understood and used in its present form. The first and foremost is that the narrative discourse of Islamic terrorism, which is under discussion right now, is based on assumption, theories, and the concept of the knowledge, which had been established in the field of study scope of terrorism. Second, the core focus of the study, which becomes central in the discourse of the Islamic terrorism as well as the pattern of narration and label used in it, was derived from a long tradition in the orientalist studies of the Middle East and the religious studies in the Arab culture. Third, many Islamic terrorism discourse refer to a long tradition of cultural stereotypes and representations of one-sided media that have often portrayed Islam and Muslim as enemy. Then the core elements of the narrative discourse of the Islamic terrorism, this narratives is always using, and we are very much familiar with these narratives. The narrative discourse of the Islamic terrorism is built on a foundation that includes the main concept in the form of assumption and label that are formed of a series of terminologies. The majority of Islamic terrorism discourse quoted the major terms such as the Islamic world, the West, the rise of Islam, political Islam, Islamism, extremism, radicalism, fundamentalism, religious terrorism, jihad, Wahhabi, Salafi, militant, moderate, global jihad movement, Al-Qaeda, and of course, the Islamic terrorism and many more. Unfortunately, however, the above terms in the textual use often refers the unclear intent. The definition often gives rise to a misinterpretation and even it's filled with stereotype cultural bias. In addition, a series of labels and the terms above are generally put together in such a way and then presented in a dramatic binary opposition. The term Islamic world, for example, is narrated in the opposition of the culture of the West. Similarly, other concepts such as extremist versus moderate, totalitarian versus democratic, secular versus religion, civilized versus barbaric. Extreme polarization within the narrative discourse seems to be intentionally enabled to build the frame of Islamic terrorism and extremists as the real life entities in the overall story and stand opposite the other entities such as peaceful society, democratic state or moderate Muslims, for example. This discourse also often includes a series of qualifications carefully designed to limit the scope of the label, the narrative of the assumption, as in the context of political or other cultures would be considered degraded. Thus, the main characteristics of the narratives of the discourse of the Islamic terrorism. The most important context exists of the whole discourse of the Islamic terrorism comes from a major assumption that violence being a fundamental factor in the cause of the terrorism is inherent in the teaching of the Islam. The reason of this assumption is that, unlike the Christianity, which has strict lines of distinction between the church and the state, Islam does not recognize the distinction between the sacred and the profane, between the religion and the politics, and therefore still perpetuated the teachings of the world in the name of the religion. In the majority of the texts, Islam is always described as a religion which regulates both private and social life so as to impact in the formation of the characteristics of the political life of its followers. These concepts are often used as the main pillar of the argument in the dominant contribution of Islam with regard to religious violence. Now, the deconstructing the myths of the Islamic terrorism, how we can deconstruct the myth of Islamic terrorism. It is usual but not scientifically right to identify Islam with terrorism. It is a double error because Islam is far from representing a monolith and many Islamic believers do not support terrorism. Only a small part of the Islamic community, Ummah, is involved in terrorism as an agent. Many Muslims become victims of the terrorist attack, and this analysis of the country report on terrorism 2017 does not leave any doubt. According to the report, more than half of all attacks took place in four countries: Iraq 23%, Afghanistan 13%, India 9%, and the Pakistan 7%. This data shows that the attacks were mainly carried out in Islamic countries, and we came to the same conclusions, verifying that more than half of all deaths took place in three Islamic countries: Iran 24%, Afghanistan 23%, and Syria 8%. These data do not match the Western idea of phenomena due to the coverage made by the media. Indeed, the Western media do not report on, give little attention to terrorist attack carried out further away from US or other Western countries. However, when there is an outrage in West, the image and the news are abundantly broadcast. This media coverage of the event has a broad effect on citizen perceptions of the terrorism. Then terrorism and the misconception of the jihad in Islam. Jihad, everyone is talking about the jihad. What is the misconception about the jihad? Later on, I will describe what Quran or the Prophet says about the jihad. Let first try to understand the misconception about the jihad. So the root of the terrorism within the Muslim community refers to the misconception and the misinterpretation of the jihad as the Quran's command. Jihad, that is to strike with the struggle, is sometimes referred to as the sixth pillar of the Islam. The Quranic teachings of the jihad have been of essential significance of Muslim self-understanding, piety, mobilization, expansion and defense. Jihad, a struggle, pertains to the difficulty and complexity of living a good life, struggling against the evil of oneself to be virtuous and moral, making a serious effort to do good works and to help to reform society depending on the circumstances which one lives. It also can mean fighting injustice and oppression, spreading and defending Islam, and creating a just society through preaching, teaching, and if necessary, armed struggle or holy war. Then there are five reasons why the West got Islamic terrorism wrong. So the clash of civilization thesis has become fashionably outdated, but still shapes the way we understand the connection between the Islam, terrorism, and the Middle East. In 2019, it is the time to forget the Middle East and change the way we perceive Islam. Vera Mironova, the renowned writer, in The New Face of Islam, he claims that the way Western thinks about Islamic terrorism has grown dangerously outdated, and the terrorist attacks that Western targets have been increasingly coming from the militants of the former Soviet Union, not the Middle East. Following on this insight, I argue that it is the time not only to forget the Middle East, but also stop essentializing Islam in the Middle East. It was often concluded that Western strategies fail because of the rigidity of strongly religious and traditional Muslim societies. These cultural expansions were shaped by the Western ethnocentric biases toward the Islam and Middle East, which lead to the following five misunderstandings. The illusion of a unified Islam, the legacy of Orientalism, Islam as a violent religion, the impact of asymmetric exercise of the power, all Muslims as a potential terrorist. So the illusion of a unified Islam. Western ethnocentrism is based on an illusion that Islam is monolithic and homogeneous. There are around 1.6 billion Muslims in the world. Muslim societies stretching from the Albania to Indonesia via Turkey have cultural differences, complexities, and contradictions, as well as different political traditions in different regions. Islam is a set of belief system in different form, political Islam or Islamism, which refers to those ideologies and the movement that strive to establish some kind of Islamic order, a religious state, Sharia law, and the moral codes in Muslim societies and the communities. There is neither a unified Islam century that transcends cultural, national, or regional differences in the Middle East, North Africa, and Asia specific, nor consolidated goals of Islamism defined by a specific political group. The second point, the legacy of the Orientalism. The age of Islamist terrorism was defined by the attack 9/11 and the following London bombs 7/7 Istanbul and Madrid bombings in the beginning of the 21st century. However, long before the age of Islamist terrorism, Western conception and representation of Muslims had already consigned them to the category of the East Oriental or Islamic world, as produced by the narrative of Orientalism. It was at the end of World War I that the Middle East was created as an imaginative geography and people by others. The people were labeled as uncivilized, traditional, irrational, and violent, and almost similar to that way they were defined by Orientalism two centuries earlier. Meanwhile, many critical thinkers had warned their readers about Western hegemony and its attempt to confirm its power against others by trying to dominate their heart and minds. Third point, Islam as a violent religion. Western ethnocentric bias frame Islam inevitably as the primary reference for the cause of violence, while the Middle East is singled out through the essentialized views of Islam as a violent religion. Religious extremism and violent practice of other religion rarely receive a similar critique. I wonder why the increasing literature on religious terrorism contained virtually nothing on the other religion. By singling out Islam as a violent religion, uncritical studies of terrorism do more harm than the good in understanding the cause of international terrorism. Next point, impact of asymmetrical exercise of the power. Essentializing Islam and the Middle East, in fact, prevent many Westerners from understanding the complex cause of power struggles. Historical, political, social, and ideological powers structures and exercise asymmetrically not only between regional states and the West, but also between oppressive regimes and marginalized groups. Without contextualizing this particular power structure, it is difficult to understand what lures an individual or groups toward the use of violent tactics and joining terrorist groups. And the last reason, all Muslims as potential terrorists. In contemporary politics, much of the Western media and right-wing popularist narrative continues adopting rather simplistic views of Islam as a violent and backward religion, and stereotypical image of Islam as irrational and grounds. On the one hand, they create a false perception of the non-Muslims as rational, non-violent, and peaceful beings. Such binary oppositions contribute towards right-wing popularist narratives and exclusionary politics of ordinary Muslims. Now, I would like to critically reflect on the concept of the Islamic terrorism. The discourse of Islamic terrorism can be challenged and contended on the three main grounds. First, the central labels and the narratives of the discourse lack academic rigor and intellectual credibility. Second, the discourse is potentially biased and functions largely to reinforce existing power structure. Third, in practice, the discourse has a number of highly damaging consequences for both counterterrorism and our democratic culture. So now, in a description, I'd like to say that how we can challenge the primary narrative. It almost goes without saying that the most of its key terms, label assumptions, and the narratives are highly problematic from a analytical perspectives, and the Islamic terrorism discourse consists of a great many simplification, misconception, and outrageous fallacies. Second, the politics of the Islamic terrorism discourse. Discourse and the knowledge it's produced is never neutral or objective. It always works for someone and for something. It is exercised in social and political power. The discourse of Islamic terrorism similarly functions politically to refine hegemony power structures. Perhaps most importantly, locating the source of terrorism in religious extremism functions to deny and obscure its political origin and the possibility that it is a response to specific Western politics. Third, the effects of the discourse. The Islamic terrorism discourse is providing harmful to community relations, public morality, and the search for effective, proportionate, and legitimate responses to terrorist acts. Westerns see Muslims as fanatical, violent, intolerant, while many Muslims have an acute view of the West. There is also evidence that increased Islamophobia, radical profiling by the police, and increase in faith hate crimes, particularly following the September 11 and London bombing, has left many individual Muslims in Britain and US feeling victimized or fearful. Now, how we can reintegrate through the destruction of the myths, reintegration through the destruction of the myths. Islamic religious terrorism and defensive war against the West persists. The West world will face an enormous threat as Western countries will have domestic and external enemies. The clash of civilization will become a real possibility. It is a scenario to be avoided, and the destruction of myth represents a necessary step for respecting the identities and learning to live together. Islamophobia is increasing in Western countries because nationalism started to identify Muslims with terrorists, or at least to blame the Muslim community for everyday problems. This is the reason for destruction of the myths. The majority of the Islamic community is peaceful and it does not support the fake holy war, but it wants its identity recognized and respected. It is why many Muslims do not like to be called moderates for fear of being seen or the poor Western. Now, I would like to explain, or I'd like to share what Quran and the Prophet says about the terrorism, what Islam says about the terrorism. I would like to quote some ayah from the Quran. O mankind, we created. This first ayah is the description of the unification of the human being. O mankind, we created you from a single pair of a male and a female, and made you into a nation and tribes, that ye may know each other, not that ye may despise each other. Verily, the most honored of you in the sight of the God, he who is the most righteous of you, and God has full knowledge and is well acquainted with all things. Al-Quran. If another ayah, if anyone slew a person, unless it be for murder or for spreading mischiefs in the land, it would be as if he slew the whole people, and if anyone save a life, it would be as if slew the life of the whole people. So it is this narrow definition terrorism that implicates only individual and the groups that has caused Muslim to be associated with the acts of destruction and the terror, as a result to become victims of hate, violence and terror themselves. Sometimes the religion of Islam is labeled responsible for the acts of handful of Muslims, and often they act as non-Muslims. So a sanctity of the human life. Another quote I'd like to take from the Quran: takes not life which God has made sacred except by way of justice and the law. Thus, though he commands you that he may learn wisdom. It means Islam considered all life form as a sacred. However, the sanctity of human life is accorded a special place. The first and foremost basic right of a human being is the right to live. The Holy Quran says, if anyone slew a person, unless it be for the murder or for spreading a mischief in the land, it would be as if he slew the whole people. And if anyone slew the life, it would be as if he saved the life of the whole people. Such in the value of the single human life, that Quran equates the taking of even one human life unjustly with killing all humanity. Does the Quran prohibit homicide in clear terms? Then ethics of war, what Quran and what our prophet says. Even in a state of war, Islam enjoins that one deals with an enemy nobly on the battlefield. Islam has drawn a clear line of distinction between the combatants and the non-combatants of the enemy country. As far as the non-combatants population is concerned, such as the women, children and the old and the infirm, etc. The instruction of the prophet are as follows: don't kill any old person, any child or any woman. Do not kill a monks in the monasteries, or do not kill the people who are sitting in the place of worship. And I would like to give an example of the prophet saying, during the war, a prophet saw the corpus of a woman lying on the grounds and observed. He said, she was not fighting, how then she came to be killed? Thus, non-combatants are guaranteed security of life even if their state is at the war with in Islamic states. Now, what is the concept of jihad as per Islam? The word jihad came from the root word jahada, which means to struggle. So jihad is literally an act of struggling. The Prophet Muhammad said that the greatest jihad is to struggle with the insidious suggestions of one's own soul. The kill, a kill or the murder of your own evil which is inside you. The jihad primarily refers to the inner struggle of being a person of virtue and submission to God in all aspects of life. Secondarily, jihad refers to the struggle against injustice. Islam, like many other religions, allows for armed self-defense or retributions against tyranny, exploitation and oppression. The Holy Quran says, Holy Quran says, and why should yet not fight in the cause of God, and those who being weak are ill-treated and oppressed, men, women and children whose cry is, our Lord rescued us from this town, whose people are oppressed and raised for us for thee, on one who will protect and raise for us from thee, on who will help. Thus Islam enjoys upon its belief to strive utmost in purifying themselves as well as in establishing peace and justice in the society. A Muslim can never be at rest when she sees injustice and oppression another hurt. Islam enjoys upon all Muslims to work actively to maintain balance with God created everything. Now, history of the tolerance. Even Western scholars have repudiated the myths of Muslim coercing others to convert. Lots of myths is there that Islam has always converted other religions into Islams. So great historian Dele Ore wrote, history makes it clear, however, that the legends of the fanatical Muslims sweeping through the world and forcing Islam at the point of sword upon conquered race is one of the most fantastically absurd myths that historians have ever repeated. Muslims ruled Spain for roughly 800 years during this time, and up until they were finally forced out, the non-Muslims there were alive and flourishing. The Holy Quran said, "Let there be no compulsion in religion. Truth stands out clear from error. Whoever rejects evil and believes in God, hard." Grasps the most trustworthy handle and knows all things. Now, Islam is the unifier, not the destroyer. Far from being a militant dogma, Islam is a way of life that transcends race and ethnicity. The Holy Quran repeatedly reminds us of our common origin. O mankind, we created you from a single pair of a male and a female and made you into nation and tribes, that ye may know each other, not that ye despise each other. Verily, the most honored of you in the sight of the God is he who is the most righteous of you, and God is full of knowledge and is well acquainted with all things, Al-Quran. So now, last is, we need to stop conflicting Islam with the terrorism. So Islam cannot be reduced to a single idea. So right-wing commentators often make statements about the Islams and Muslims that are factually incorrect. They dominate Muslims and proclaim that Islam is incompatible with Western democratic values. This is not at all true, but Islam cannot be reduced to a single theological framework or simplistic worldwide. Then Muslims are often victims of the Wahhabi extremism. The next move from this right-wing figures is usually to argue that Wahhabism is the essence of Islam, that moderate Muslims are just not following their own sacred taste. They usually proceed by cherry picking verses from the Quran, and historically narration proved that Muhammad was warlord. This completely ignores the fact that there have been debate for centuries within Islam over the historical context, interpretation, and even accuracy of these cherry-picked parts of the vast compulsion of Islamic scripture taken by the Wahhabis. Right-wing extremism reams of Islamic extremism by conflating Wahhabism and mainstream Islam. The far right is creating the enforcing the strength of its only enemy, alienating and harshing Muslims in the ways to run risk of the ridiculizing some of them and making them argument that Islam is incompatible with democracy and human rights, suggests that Wahhabi readings of Islam is in fact the correct one. This reinforces the clash of civilization thesis that argues that Western and Islam worldwide are fundamentally incompatible, that they are destined for perpetual conflicts. Last is, the West must reassess its narratives about Islam. It is natural to West to understand the deeper root cause, the Christchurch massacre, and the potential role played by Islamic extremism. But the culprits remain the same, those who promote the idea that Islam and liberal democratic values are incompatible. In conclusion, I would like to say, could we have the globalized world with no discrimination and aggression. Such view of globalization requires all citizens of the world to have mutual understanding of their similarities with other humans and their need for the safety. As human of different race, religion, and civilization, it is important that we continue to learn from one another our glorious past as well as our pain. In the process of this mutual dialogue, all religious leaders and policymakers should attempt to carry on responsibility for the creation of a peaceful world. Muslims certainly carry the heaviest load, since Islam has been consistently described as the epitome of radicalism, terrorism, and evil religion. Such a high-tech portrayal of Islam does not accord with Islamic teachings that promulgate tolerance and understanding of other religious beliefs, language, and civilization. In the process, it is important for Muslims to reinterpret Islamic teaching so that Muslims combat the misuse of the Quran and Hadith in the name of religion, as has been done by the global terrorists. Along with this attempt, the change in the foreign policy and public opinion of the rest of the world would decrease the prejudice against Islam and Muslims. Last, I would like to say that terrorism has no religion, terrorists have no religion and they are friend of no religion. Everyone, if we remember these things, the world will be a global village and we can maintain the brotherhood among all. All the religions, irrespective of the religion in this world. Thank you. Thank you. If there is any question, you can share or you can ask. I'm open for the questions.
Thank you, Mr. Baharul. Thank you for your talk. We got to learn so many things. At this juncture, I just want to share what Friedrich Nietzsche said. Friedrich Nietzsche, a German philosopher, he said that there is no truth, but there are interpretations. The world is a victim of interpretation. For thousands and thousands of years, history of human civilization, we have interpreted, reinterpreted, and we allow ourselves to be victim of interpretations and reinterpretations and the clashes of ideologies, right? Okay, so we got to learn a lot from Sir Baharul. So I open this platform for the questions. If there are any questions, we will welcome, and Sir is willing to answer. Please go ahead. Okay, before they ask any question, I want to ask one question to you, sir.
Please, sir.
Throughout your speech, lecture, you have emphasized upon the fact that how Quranic texts have been misinterpreted or reinterpreted or politically interpreted, right? So my question is that, if the religious texts have been reinterpreted and misinterpreted in the political context, and whose responsibility it is to introduce people to the truth? Whose responsibility it is? It is the responsibility of people who are socially motivated, intellectually motivated, whose hearts are full of compassion, and those who dream about the world which is free of artificially created barriers. But unfortunately, this type of movement has not seen in the Islam. What is your take on it?
True, sir. Because, Islam, as I have mentioned, that the starting of Islam was very interesting, and it has grown rapidly, having a science, research and all these things. But suddenly Islam has confined themselves into their own artificial ideology, and they presume that they will run according to the history from where they have come. They were not ready to accept the modernization or Western developments. They are not ready to accept the development which is going on in the other part of the world. So this is another reason, and they always try to suppress the moderate peoples that in the name of the Quran, that Quran says say these things, Quran has said these things. So it is a very few numbers of the people, those who are developing or literating or improving themselves through the Western educations. This is the one of the reasons that when somebody is coming and some political leader is using the Quran and some nitpick ticks of the Quranic ayat into their political discussion, so we become afraid, the people become afraid, okay, Quran says these things, the Quran is the originated from the Allah. So there is a strong misconception that people are telling that this the Quran is Allah. Quran is an code which will always help you to the way of life, how you have to spend the life in this world. But we have a misconception that we would like to lead our life as per the Quran, but we are not ready to accept what is actually going to happening in the world. Yes, we cannot deny the parts of the Quran. We have to take the ethics from the Quran. Along with that, we have to accept the modernization. Nowadays, you will see, sir, that in Islam, Islamic community or the Muslim communities, the girls are not getting that much of status. Whereas the prophet has always fight for the girls' education or the women education. So they are the political leaders who are always misrepresenting the interpretation of the Quran, and hardly a very small number of people are aware of the Quran in their own language. Even in our society also, people are reading the Quran in Arabic, but hardly a few number of people can understand the meaning of the Quran. So what people are doing, our leaders, they are always afraid, or they are always trying to suppress the people that you should not read the Quran in other language. So we need to spread, those who are educated, we need to spread that information, and we need to educate ourselves the interpretation, the original interpretation or the positive interpretation of the Quran in our own language. Then only we can educate ourselves. Along with that, we have to educate ourselves in the modern or the Western education and Western development also. So this is the initiative, and education must be spreaded. The people, those who are have the opportunity or had the opportunity to develop ourselves with the modern education, or we have the taste of the globalization, we need to work on this marginalized class or the backward class of the Islamic community to uplift them. Then only, I think, sir, we can spread the message of the true Islam and the true meaning of the Quran, and we can stop the political leaders, their misinterpretation of the Quran. Okay, I have this one question, that how would you differentiate the terrorism from the secessionist and the segregationist movement? See, terrorism in Islam, there was a movement when they have fight against the other religions, especially the Christians and Jews and other things. So that we cannot consider as a movement. That was a fight, that we can consider as a movement, because on that time, the people are attacking the Muslims, those who would like to unify in the faith of the one religion, or those who would like to accept the Islam, and all the time Islam was spreading. But we cannot consider terrorist activity as a movement. This is a terrorism, always a state sponsor activity. We have to remember, a terrorism group is not a self-financed group. They are always a politically influenced and politically financed. The political leaders of the state is sponsoring them, and they're using these groups for their own benefits. So movement is always to achieve certain goal, and that must be a noble goal. But this terrorist activity never considered as a movement, because a terrorism itself, the word origin, created terror. A movement cannot create a terror. So there is a huge difference between movement and the terrorist activity. Terrorist activities is always a negative sense. It is always humanity, always against the world of humanism.
Sir, thank you so much for your elaborate answer to the question asked by Madam Avive. Yes, in 2018, I just want to inform you that Tetzel College has organized one roundtable conference on religious intolerance. And somewhere I feel that, as Madam Avive also said, that we need to create platforms to break the barriers, the man-made barriers, and to bring the hearts together.
True, sir.
We need to create more platforms for dialogues. We need to create more platforms for understanding. We need to create more platforms which will help us to find the solution rather than blindly criticizing, right? Issues are there. Definitely issues are there. So in this context, let me ask you one question, which is a very burning question in the context of Islamic theology. That is about the problem of Wahhabism.
Yes.
I mean, as far as my knowledge goes, that Wahhabism has become an instrumental ideology in encouraging terrorism, right?
Yes.
So how
this
Wahhabism came into being, how this Wahhabism, the radical, became a radical face of Islam, right? Can you please elaborate on it, and how to tackle this theological challenge?
Yes, sir. Thank you for this question, sir. Actually, sir, the Wahhabism concept has been originated when Islam is fighting with the other religions in their initial stages. So on the time a prophet has declared war, isn't a declared war against the Christians or the Jews, those who are attacking the Muslim religion, and they were targeting the Muslims. And after that war, they were the part of that war, and from there that Wahhabism concept has been originated. Now after the war, the Wahhabis are thinking that this anybody who is a non-Muslim or who is not the believer of the Islam is the enemies of the Islam. Even they are targeting the Muslims, those who are not faith in the Wahhabis. So it is not like that Wahhabism is targeting only the non-Muslim. They are targeting targeting the Muslims also. So the war has been ended even during the time of the Muhammad also. But Wahhabis are continuing that wars against this present scenario, against the non-Muslims or against every religious peoples in the present societies. So they are believing into their ideology that war is still going on, but there is no war in the 21st century. The war against war to save the Islam has been declared by the Prophet and has been ended by the Prophet during the lifetime of the Prophet. So the Wahhabis are not ready to accept that concept that war has been stopped, but they are believing that yes, war is still going on. How long we will be surviving and how long we will be in this earth, we don't want to let others to live in this earth. This is a wrong conception. This is a movement, this is the wrong movement or the wrong things generated into the ideology of the Wahhabis.
Okay, sir, there is one more question coming
from Naburun, sir. Sir, in your opinion on distinguished statement of the Honorable Bombay High Court that Tablighi Jamaat were scapegoated, can you connect this blame of the Tablighi with the Islamophobia? No, sir, in this concept, I don't like to refer this matter, because we are discussing about the terrorism, and this Islamophobia, Tablighi Jamaat is a propaganda used by, I would like to quote the Bombay High Court, that it is a propaganda used by the political leaders to defame that the foreigners, those who have been detained by the Mumbai police. So here we are discussing about the terrorism, and terrorism is against the state. And yes, this may be a reason which will generate some sort of hatred among the peoples of the Muslims, which will help us to believe in the Wahhabi concept or the extremist concept. They can convince the people that see how the Islam is treating in India, you can join us, we can fight for the jihad, which is completely wrong. Jihad is fight against yourself, your evils, which is inside you. Jihad is to eradicate your negative thinkings, wrong thinkings. Jihad in one ayat, Quran has mentioned, you can declare the jihad as in holy war. That war does not mean against the human being, against the humanity. The war is against yourself. You have to declare war against yourself. That is jihad. So I don't think there's no need to refer this Tablighi Jamaat concept. Bombay High Court has elaborately to the point has sought out or shows that whatever the propaganda has been spread during that Tablighi Jamaat, it is completely wrong. So, and interestingly, I would like to share one my personal opinion. These controversial topics, people are not willing to discuss, but in an open platform. See, here we are having few number of people, but everybody is watching, everybody is knowing that fact, but people are not ready to come forward to ask question why this is happening. Either it is a Muslim or either it is a non-Muslim. No people are coming forward. We are discussing this thing at our home, inside the room. That stereotype concept we have to break. We have to come out and we have to ask why only Islamic terrorism? Why terrorism will be connected with the this Islam? The Islamic people, the other people, the people need to come forward and ask the question, those who are writing Islamic terrorism or using this narrative, Islamic terrorism, the terrorism with Islam, Muslim and all these things. Everyone is, in every religion, everyone is not a criminal. Criminals have no religion. Criminals have no ideology. They are simply doing the act which is against the humanity. So a Muslim, non-Muslim, everyone need to come. The world need to be a global place where everybody can survive. Everybody can live with the concept of brotherhood. We have to confine our religion as a my personal thinking. We should not make it a public. In a public, we should be brother and we should focus on the brotherhood. This is my concept.
Very well, very well. Your points are well taken, sir. Are there any other question? Because
please,
see,
yes,
I really doubt that this topic, will it be discussed in any other platform? So since we have resource persons, since we have expert in the field, take an opportunity and please ask questions.
Yes, ask any question. I do not mind. Ask any question. I clarify your doubts.
Yes, yes. I like what you spoke about stereotypes. We are victims of stereotypes.
Yes, at our home only, sir.
Yes, yes, yes. And
we need to break that thing from our home. We need to start the journey from our home. We should not discuss the things only among our family members. We should discuss with our friends in the outside the home. So the people, those who are afraid to discuss about this topic, they will get some energy. Okay, we will be the part of this discussion. Only this way only we can start that movement. That religion has nothing to do with the terrorist activity or extremist activity.
That is well taken and understandable. My question is that why is it such a movement for reforms have not been initiated in the Islamic world? Of course, you have already partially answered that.
Yes, sir.
That there are powerful political leaders, there are ulemas, the clerics, and they have a very good influence over the society.
Yes,
but my question is that somewhere society has to rise, somewhere the truth of light shall power in the society. That is the way to growth. That is the way to evolution. Then how it is going to happen in the Islamic society? When will it happen? And who will take it? What is your view as a young representative of your religion, young representative of your society? How do you propose that Muslims or Islamic society should free from its own mumbo jumbo?
Yes, sir. True, sir. Thank you, sir. So in my personal experience and after researching on the Islamic terrorism, the Islam at present time, Islam is facing one weakness, that is the education. You'll see, comparison to other religion in Islam, education, yes, we are considering ourselves so-called education. And if somebody is having a knowledge, gaining knowledge from the madrasa or other things, we are considering ourselves as an education. Education is, no, we have to educate ourselves from a modern technological development, modern educational concepts, and we have to read other religion also. Number one. Number two, we have to break the stereotypes that if we are performing namaz, if we are reading the Quran, if we are following the hadith and this sunnah, we will be having the jannat. So jannat is another thing. We need to work on this earth. When Almighty has sent us to this earth, every person has been sent by the God in this earth with a particular purpose. And all this purpose, the first and foremost purpose is the humanity. You need to spread the humanism, brotherhood into the society. Number two. Number three, that we need to, concept of this so-called madrasas and all these things must be well equipped through the Western education or the developed education of a society. Number three, every Muslim person should raise their voice whenever they are facing any injustice among themselves, either it is from Islam itself or any other religion. Fourth, the judiciary also take necessary steps to stop this or to break these stereotypes, or whenever any media or any other print media or any media or any electronics media or the political leaders are using these so-called stereotypes or so-called words which will directly defame the Islam or any other religion, we need to stop these things. So I think in this way, And another thing, more representation in the politics is very important, especially Muslim women should take part in the politics actively. Muslim women and Muslim women with highly qualifications, and they need to take part in the politics, because we are, even the Arabic countries are also transforming into the democratic countries. Though we are living in a 21st century, there are lots of Muslim countries, those who are in a democratic country, but few Arabic countries, those who are ruled by the Sultan or so-called kings. So here also, if we can convert or we can implement the democratic concept, participation of every caste, creed, and Muslim communities, male, female, from every age old, so they need to participate in the politics, because it is the legislature who is framing the rules. So they have to frame the rules frame the rules, and they can make the policies which can uplift the backward Muslims, and through this way we can remove this this so-called Islamophobia or this kind of stereotype concepts. And another one is, the Muslims should take part in the judiciary as well, because judiciary has a great role to play. The legalization of the concepts and the proper implementation of the policies or making the rules. The legislature sometimes making the rules, but due to some pressure, but it is not implementing. So in this concept, the judiciary can take part actively and raise the voice that why these things has not been implemented properly.
Okay. Another question from my side, since other questions are not coming.
Actually, I just want to ask.
I'm going
question.
To take every
Please,
advantage.
Hello.
Oh, Harsh, please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Harsh,
please go ahead.
I just want to ask one question. As you are saying that for very long that the Muslim community is facing the challenges of not getting education and not getting the privilege, all sorts of education privilege, so that they can bring themselves. The thing is that when we have a when we have a president of India, a Muslim, appointed as a Muslim, who is a scientist and educationist and everything, so we cannot say that the Muslims are not getting the privilege to get educated. The only thing which they are lacking is that the guidance, proper guidance, and this guidance is where I am sorry to say, but the thing is that whenever we, for so long, we need these teachers, these mullahs, these pundits, and also in my religion also in pandits and mullahs or maulanas and all. We need them to teach us what our religion is saying. But if this things continue, we are not able to really make the society a very better society, because each and every one in this society is going through following the chain of the pundits and all these religious leaders, so-called religious leaders, but nobody is caring that yes, we must take the book, read it, whether it's Quran, Gita, anything, whether it's, we have to take it and read it and make it properly to understand themselves that yes, this is wrong and this is right. We have to make up our mind that yes, this is wrong and this is right. Now, secondly, you have previously you have said that the nationalism, the concept of nationalism, should be if the concept of nationalism is there, you cannot take a religion, religious. The nationalism is going to destroy the religious faith and Quran and everything, and even the religious. I'd like to tell you one thing. The thing is that we must abide the law, whatever the government is. But secondly, you have the concept of getting the remedies in every country. Living Korea and you are not living in a Korea and something else, some other rigid. Governmental society, you are living in a democracy, so you have a remedy, that is court, and you have a remedy, that is your fundamental right to protest. But if you are going and saying that my religion is in harm and my religion is getting some of the other killings and I'm not able to speak in a democratic world, if you are saying that, it's a really a shocking thing. Now, thirdly, if you say that the many of the society cannot able to say the not able to raise their voice in front of the religious leaders. Sorry to say that if you are not able to raise your voice at that moment of time, you have no right to say that yes, your religious is in harm. You are getting discriminated. You are getting attacked by any other religion. Because always remember one thing: a religious leader, if tells you that the other religion is harming you, and the other religious teaching is not as so appropriate, and the other religion is making you the discrimination and other thing, then I really want to tell you that you must change the gurus which you are following. In spite of that yes, following and believing their teachings, which we are keep on doing for a very long time. Thank you for your thank you.
Okay, sir, I would like to answer you four points. First of all, you have asked about the interpretation of the Quran. I think in my discussion, I have already discussed the Quran has been read out by the Muslim in Arabic. I have already suggested during my presentation, even the answering on questions, that Quran should be read out by the own language so the people can understand, so the Muslim can understand, and they can interpret by themselves. Number one. Number two, I am not asking that the people are not getting justice. Yes, everyone is getting justice. In my suggestion is the representation in the legislation and the judiciary of the Muslims. I am not talking about the India. I am talking about the whole world. So if we are having more representation in the legislation and the judiciary, so they can be an inspiration for the other Muslims. Number three, that the remedy. Yes, I am not discussing about the talking about that the people are afraid of the discussion. Yes, people are not discussing the mainstream things. If I'll take that the Bombay High Court judgment, when this thing is going on during Tablighi Jamaat, entire media has covered that things. But unfortunately, today there is no coverage. So it's just an example, don't take it otherwise. So my concept is that if the people are talking these things about the Islams or about any religion, not only Islam, about any religion in a public place, it will be a warning to the political leader also. They will be afraid or they will be think twice before making any wrong statement before the public, because political leader thinks people are not talking publicly. So they think they are afraid of. So that propaganda will be breaked down. And last thing, yes, sir, everyone is getting remedy. There are countries where people are not getting remedy. And we know who is getting the remedy, who can reach to the court. But the question is, how many people can reach to the court? Unless and until you cannot reach to the court, the court is not able to provide the remedy. My recommendation is, if we can educate ourselves, we can encourage ourselves, we can implement every policy to the last man of the world, then the people will self-generated. What is a jihadist telling, which I have quoted, that we have to kill our evil along with it to educate ourselves. My recommendation is, if every community is educating their self, they are know about the rights and duties, and they know how to get that their right to be protected, then they can come to the court. If you take any country, not how many percentage of people are able to reach to the court. Those who are coming to the court, they are getting justice, they are getting remedy. I am not denying their things. My message is how to bring that backward class people to come to the front. And sir, every country is having the policies. Even I am also agreeing, but I am not denying that thing. I am telling that the Islam or every religion should accept the policies and should upgrade them for getting better justice and better facilities.
Thank you, sir. But the biggest remedy you already got in the constitution, that to right to vote, and every 5 years you got that remedy to change who you are just following.
Sir, you and me, everyone knows what is the harsh reality of our voting. Voting day is celebrated as a holiday in India, and because of our carelessness, so we have to spread the message that this is your right, this is your weapon. Please use it. How many percentage of people are casting their votes, sir?
Yes, true. Previously also then 64% in total.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Harsh Chaturvedi, thank you so much. Sir Baharul Islam, there is one more
Please,
question
sir.
Waiting for you. And this question has been asked by Fatma bin Sultana, and she's saying that, thank you, sir, for your wonderful presentation. My question to you, Fatma bin Sultana asked, as far as I know, there are two types of jihad, defensive and aggressive jihad. Is it right, sir? If right, then explain it kindly. So, see, another question about, you know, the aggressive and defensive. So we have no idea about it. So can you please explain to all of us?
Yes, sir. Aggressive jihad and defensive jihad. See, this is, sir, to some extent, I would like to refer our IPC. IPC, we are having a general exclusion clause where we have a right to defense. Here, defensive jihad is like, defensive jihad is something like that. If somebody is harming you, you have every right to protect yourself. And in IPC also, we are having our right. We can utilize the general exceptions, these things. If somebody is harming you, you can save yourself. For that reason, you may go for harming. That harm may be hard or grievous hard or even the murder also. And this is a defensive. Aggressive jihad is to control our anger, to control our evils, which is inside us. That is aggressive jihad. Defensive is external to resist the external enemies which will harm you. Not in the name of religion, not in the name of any other things, which will directly harm your human body. When you are resisting and you are protesting, that is called the defensive jihad. You are defending yourself. And aggressive jihad is always to kill your inner evils.
Okay. Thank you for your answer, sir. And I will be taking two more questions.
Please,
only
sir.
Two questions.
Okay, sir.
Is there any other question? If no, then I will ask my one question.
Sir, please.
One question is that when we speak about arrested terrorists, okay,
yes, sir.
Like take an example of Indonesia. Okay, there are various examples that terrorists have been arrested by the armed forces, right?
Yes, sir.
In other parts of the world also,
yes,
terrorists
sir.
Have been arrested by the armed forces. And the psychological profile of the terrorist. Now listen to me,
yes,
very carefully. The psychological profile of the terrorist have proved that he has been heavily indoctrinated due to religious, I call it mumbo jumbo. I don't believe it's a philosophy, but I call it mumbo jumbo, the selective interpretation of the religion. So he is being injected with the thoughts of selective interpretation of religion. And we are talking about Islam, Islamic terrorism. So my question is that, how would you propose to reform those terrorists? How do you propose to clean their minds? Of course, terrorism is a crime against humanity, not just a crime within the jurisdiction of one country or another country. Terrorism has been identified clearly by various international jurisdictions that it is a crime against humanity. International crime. Now the question is, somebody wants to reform, or rather there is a policy of reformation, of surrender terrorists, right, the Islamic terrorists. So how would you propose to reform their minds, which is already being cluttered due to mumbo jumbo of selective interpretation of Islam? Your take on it.
Thank you, sir. So first of all, sir, whenever our armed forces is arresting a Muslim terrorist, so-called Muslim terrorist, they are naming it as an Islamic terrorism. So it is not like that terrorism is confined into Islam only. Other religious groups is also there. So whenever they are arresting any person, they are not telecasting or they are not protecting that they have arrested Sikh or say X religion, Y religion, Z religion. Only if a terrorist is a Muslim, then they are naming that Islamic terrorism, number one. Number two, if you see the profile or the background of the terrorist, say for example, sir, if we take the Ajmal Kassab, see, they are struggling. They are having a 5 or 4 members in the society, in their family. They are unable to feed them. So this extremist group or this terrorist organization is targeting those people, those who are very poor. They are living in a poverty. Second, they are having very limited education. Fourth, they are ready to do anything for feeding their family. So they are targeting those people, and they are motivating, or they are brainwashing, so-called brainwashing them with the negative thoughts. So we need to first identify, sir, whenever our armed forces or anywhere in the world a person has been arrested, they should not represent that terrorist or a terrorist group in the name of religion. First. Second, we need to educate. We need to, again and again I'm telling, sir, we need to educate that groups. And especially, sir, young age. In young age, it is very easy. It is the psychologically it has been proved. In our young age, or the age from teen to young, in that time, our brain is working in this way that we are ready to do whatever we'd like to do. So in that time, if somebody would like to inject the negative things, and they are showing certain fake dreams that yes, if you're doing this thing, you're doing in the name of religion. If you're doing these things, you will get the Jannat, the who's will is waiting. These are all nonsense, bogus things has been sprayed by these our so-called extremist groups or the Amullahs. So what they have to do, basically we have to take care of that young minds, that they should not be diverted in the name of the religion. So special care need to be taken to the especially young minds, those who are uneducated, those who are struggling for jobs, those who are living in the poverty, and those who are having a huge burden into their shoulder to take care of their families.
Okay, if there are no more questions,
sir, I would like to counter.
Oh yes, please go ahead. Last one.
Sir, you have just said that the armed forces are protecting that these are projecting their religion before whenever they arrested any Muslim, they project their religion. I'm really sorry to say that no armed, I have listened each and every armed forces conference, whenever they arrest any person, any terrorist, they have never ever said that it's an Islamic terrorist. They have never quoted that they only said that the name of the person. They have never said, because in Manipur area also our armed forces have killed many terrorists. They have only stated the name of those terrorists, but never said that they belong to a Hindu, they belong to a Muslim community or any other community.
Sir, I would like to counter your statement. There are a number of cases where the statement has been given, if any incident occurs, there is a linkage of the Islamic group, quote unquote Islamic group. It already signifies that Islam has been already broadcasted.
Sorry to say, in a counter
Okay.
Yes, sir. So, sir, not only Islam, sir, I am against the disclosure of the religion of any criminal, because the criminal doesn't have any religion.
The thing is right, that many of the terrorist organizations. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes, both of your points are well taken. And yes, it has been a wonderful discussion. And I am really happy that finally the world will strive for the peace, whether you are Hindu, whether you are Muslim, whether you are Christian, whether you are a Sikh, or whether you are a case. You have every right to see the world which is full of peace, compassion, justice, equality, liberty, and also fraternity. I am a follower of Jesus Christ, and I understand the value of universal brotherhood. So let us pledge that henceforth in our life, we will not discriminate anybody in the name of caste, religion, sex, or gender. Let us create more bridges, let us create more relations, let us understand we all are human beings. There will be differences, there will be disturbances, but
at the end, we all are one. We all are children of God. At the end, we all are children of God. Mr. Baharul Islam, thank you so much. And dear participants, thank you so much for your participation. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. It's really a great honor. And Harsha, thank you so much for pointing and countering my points. It's really a great discussion. Hope you don't mind. And I believe in only one religion in this earth, that is the brotherhood, sir. We have to work to establish brotherhood, not the establishment of any religion. The religion always divides us. The religion always creates confusions. Only the brotherhood, friendshipness, that will be the only religion in the society through which we can live long and we can make our universe as a heaven.
Yes, sir. True, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.